So in the last lecture we discussed about the response build up at resonance stage. For forced vibration which is damped and undamped, the moment I say damped, we discussed the viscous damping model. We already understood that when you have a damped system, even at resonance, when the excitation frequency is equal to the natural frequency of vibration of a model, which is nothing but root of k by m, the response becomes bounded, which is where zeta is what we call as the damping ratio, where zeta is c by cc. The ratio of critical damping is what the present damping what we are using. So in today's lecture we will talk about half power band width method, which will estimate the zeta value for a given system, and we will also quickly see some of the interesting application problems in single degree. Of course we have 3 tutorials already, 2 I have given you, but still I am projecting it today. One I will solve it as an exercise sheet, then for further exercises I will print some more tutorials and give you, you can keep on solving them as a self exercise. So do we have any questions till this stage as we have discussed so far? From anybody, any doubt, any questions? So having said this, let us try to talk about estimation of damping. Damping is inherently present in ocean structural systems because of fluid structure interaction. So we are worried only about the damped model, and we are also more focused towards viscous damping. We have explained the reasons of all these things in the previous lectures. Now estimating of damping for a free vibration analysis has been already done using an experimental data. If you have an experimental data where the response time history of any body which is vibrating is known to you, you can pick up the peaks, may be successive, may be alternative, any number you want, and we have an expression for the logarithmic decrement based on which I can compute the damping ratio zeta. This is one way of estimating damping. There is another way of estimating damping which we call as half power band width method. We will see this method quickly now. So getting the feedback from what we had in the last lecture, we already said x of t, which is rho sin omega t minus theta, where rho is the resultant response, which is p0 by k 1 by 1 minus beta square plus 2 zeta beta the whole square. Where beta is the ratio of frequencies and zeta is the damping ratio. Of course p0 by k is called x static, because of static deflection. Based on this, we already said my dynamic amplification factor amounts to dAf which is 1 minus beta square the whole square plus 2 zeta beta the whole square to the power of minus half. So at beta equals 1, that is when the excitation frequency is as same as the natural frequency of vibration, at beta equals 1 my d becomes 1 by 2 zeta analytically from this expression. I also know x of t by x static from this equation, x of t by x static, p 0 by k will go away. I can write rho sin omega t minus theta. Now I try to plot at beta. I vary only the excitation frequency because I know omega n value. So for different excitation frequency in hertz, I try to plot the response amplitude. Let us say the plot, what I get from this by varying omega alone for a specific omega n appears like this. So obviously there will be a peak which you will get when these values are equal. I call this peak as A, which is the peak of this response. After knowing this value, I draw an horizontal line at 1 by root 2 of this peak. This will now intersect the response curve at 2 frequencies. I call this as F1 and F2. These points are called half power points. So I say xt by x static, substituting back in this equation, sin omega t minus theta by root of whole square. Let me call this as equation number 1 for our discussion. I remove this. Now at x equals 1 by root 2 of the peak value, I apply this equation. So let us see what happens. So we already know d is 1 by 2 zeta, we already know this value. So we also know x is x static by root of 1 minus beta square plus 2 zeta beta the whole square. I equate this to x static of root 2 of zeta of 2 zeta, sorry, root 2 of 2 zeta. So, x static anyway in both equations goes away, rearrange them, square them and eliminate higher powers of zeta. Let us see what we get. Can you quickly do this? Simplify this, it will be a quadratic equation. Eliminate higher powers of zeta and simplify. The roots will be beta 1 and beta 2, okay, beta 1 because the quadratic in beta. So, if you simplify, I get beta 1 and beta 2 as 1 minus zeta square 1 plus zeta minus zeta. So, beta 2 minus beta 1 will be 2 zeta, this goes away, this goes away, gets added up, get plus 2 zeta. So, on the other hand, zeta is beta 2 minus beta 1 by 2. And beta already we know is omega by omega n, let us me substitute back. So, I will get this as half of omega 2 minus omega n by omega 2 by omega n. Or corresponding to this figure, I will get half f 2 minus f 1 by Fn. And the peak will occur at the midpoint of these two, obviously, because it is a symmetric curve. So, I can also say Fn is F1 plus F2 by 2, therefore, zeta will be F2 minus F1 by F1 plus F2. So, if we simply have a plot of response amplitude versus varying only the excitation frequency for a known omega n, we get a plot, get the peak, bounded peak, because zeta is not 0. For zeta not 0, any value other than 0, you get a bounded value. We already seen this in the last lecture. So, you get a bounded peak, pick up that value, take 1 by root 2 of that value, draw an horizontal line, it will intersect the curve in both places, get the corresponding frequencies. If you know these values, you will get zeta at which this curve was drawn from this expression. So, it is one of the interesting way of computing zeta. This method is called half power band width method, because the band width is determined by an half power point, that is why it is called half power band width method. This is very common method wherein you can estimate zeta if you have the plot, okay. We have discussed formally the single degree freedom system models completely. I will take up some application examples now. We will solve them here. There are 4 problems I will solve now here. I will give you some more problems for the exercise. You try to solve them. If you have difficulty, we can then discuss it here later. After finish this exercise today, tomorrow I will move on to 2 degrees and multi degree freedom system models for another 3 or 4 more classes. That is the plan. So, we finish multi degree discussions, we will have an examination quiz 1, okay. So, single degree, 2 degree, multi degree discussions we complete, we will take up an exam on quiz 1, then we will extend further discussion on multi degree In the next module, I will talk about dynamic analysis of different kinds of offshore structures, where I will also show you how dynamic analysis can be done for different class of structures with software support. So we will make an online presentation, I will show you how this can be done with the screenshots of different software for different kinds of structures. We will discuss the results from the research papers directly. We will not be able to run it here, it takes a lot of time. I will discuss the results directly, but I will give you the methodology how it was done. That will discuss in module 2, after which we will again take a quiz. Then in module 3 we will talk about stochastic dynamics. That is the plan, okay. So the first module, first degree single degree freedom system, will get completed today with the 4 example problems which we will solve now. So I will project the problems, let us try to solve one by one. So tutorial 1. So already we have discussed this, how will you estimate the wind forces, I will give you the printout sheet of this, we have discussed this, a theory question. Tutorial 2 was again estimating the member forces, 3 problems. Tutorial 3 is what we will solve here as an exercise sheet. Are you able to read it? So the following data are given for a vibrating system with viscous damping. (4.5 kg) stiffness, 30 N/m, damping constant C 0.12 N/m/s, because it is viscous damping, so it becomes 0.12 N/s/m. What we want is find the logarithmic decrement of this. So try to solve this problem, let us see, are you able to do it? So you can compute omega n, k and m are known to me, so which is 30/4.5, which comes to how much? 2.8 N/s. I can also estimate critical damping. What is the equation for this? 2m ωn. I know the value of m and I know the value of omega n. This comes to 23.22, and zeta is the ratio of C by CC. C is given as 0.12. CC we know, so zeta is expressed in percentage of, are we getting this? Calculate zeta and see. So what is the logarithmic decrement? What is the expression for logarithmic decrement? Delta is 2π zeta by 1 minus zeta square. can compute this. So 2 pi 0.0052 by root of 1 minus how much is this? How much? 0.033. So the first thing asked is logarithmic decrement. The second thing asked is find the ratio of any two successful amplitudes. So I want amplitude ratio. Which is x1 by x2, because it is decreasing, it is not x2 by x1. So which is nothing but e delta, is it not? It is exponential decay. So e power delta 1.2, is it okay? So the successive amplitudes keep on decreasing by so many times of the earlier one. That is what asked in the first question, okay. Second question, is this clear to all of us? Shall I remove this? Let us say question number 2. For small damping zeta very insignificant, show that the logarithmic decrement can be expressed in terms of vibration energy and the energy dissipated per cycle. So how do we approach this problem? Let us say this is my plot, I understand. Let us say look at the positive peaks x1, x2, x3. Let us say xn. So I already know x2 by x1 is e power minus delta. Which is given as 1 minus delta plus delta square by 2 factorial and so on, is it not? We can expand this e power exponential series. What is the vibration energy? Let us say I am looking for the energy at the first level u1, which is half k x1 square. Look at the second amplitude u2, half k x2 square. System is same, so stiffness will not vary. What is the loss of energy? U1 is higher or u2 is higher? Loss of energy u1 minus u2 with respect to u1. Let us try to find out that. I will write it here. So loss of energy. U1 minus U2 by U1. Substitute for U1 and U2, apply this equation. What do we get? You will get this as 1 minus X2 square by X1 square. Is that okay? Are we getting it? So X2 by X1 already I know as e power minus delta. So 1 minus X2 by X1 the whole square can also be written as 1 minus e to the power of minus 2 delta, I can expand it. So how do you expand it? 1 minus 1 minus 2 delta plus 2 delta the whole square by 2 factorial minus and so on, is it not? For smaller values of delta, why? The problem says for small damping, ok. For smaller values of damping, what is the ratio? Delta U by U. Will be equal to what? 2 delta, is it not? I think it should be delta, I think I am writing rho. Please correct this. So, I can connect the logarithmic decrement to my vibration energy. Okay, I know the logarithmic decrement, I can find out the vibration energy difference from this expression. Okay, any doubt? Can you take away this? Question number 3, direct application problem. Let us say I have an offshore platform whose deck is supported by a truss system, whose deck is supported by a truss system. A typical truss system is shown here, I am drawing it here. Though in reality the truss system for which an offshore platform deck is supported will be complex, but I am taking a very simple system for demonstration. So, it has got a specific support condition, both ends are hinged. All the cross section areas of the members are equal, length of the members are equal. So, L, L, L. To impose this condition, this degree will be 45. I name this joints as A, B, C, D, E and F. I want to find the frequency of vibration of this truss system for a load suspending here. That is the question asked. A deck of top side is truss supported system as shown in the figure below. By neglecting the self weight of the truss, so mass of the truss by itself is neglected in this problem. Estimate the frequency of vibration of the truss by idealizing a simple spring mass system. Assume that the area of cross section and length of all the members are same. How do we approach this problem? So, I draw two truss here. I put W, we already know W is mg, and actually replace this m by this equation, ok. So, let me put W here because I am going to apply a force which is going to cause free vibration to the truss at this point. The moment I apply a force here, let us look at this joint. I must select a joint where there are not more than 2 unknowns. First, let me find the reactions. This is symmetric, therefore, obviously, this will be W by 2, this will also be W by 2. Is that agreed? So, select any joint and do by method of joints. Select any joint where there are not more than two unknowns. What are the unknowns? All the internal forces in these members are unknowns. What are these members? A, B, C, D, E, F. The force in the member A, B, B, C, F, C, A, D, B, D, B, F, E, B are not known to me. Okay, they are unknowns. So, select any joint where there are not more than two unknowns. Select this joint, for example, there are three unknowns. Select this joint, for example, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 unknowns. So, I cannot handle this. Select this joint, there are two unknowns. One is the vertical force on the member AD, other is the member AB, is it not? So, since there is no horizontal force acting here in the whole system, I can say this is 0, okay, and this will be W by 2, because this has to oppose this force here. I use a simple equation of equilibrium here and try to solve this. Similarly, by symmetry, and of course 0. So, can you solve the remaining quickly? This angle is 45 degrees, that is given here. So, what would be the next joint you select? You cannot do the joint B, you select either D or F. So, select the joint D. I hope we all know how to solve this, right? So, I get this as a tensile member, which will be W by root 2, and this becomes a compression member as W by 2. Same way here, W by 2, W by root 2. So, at this joint B, there are no horizontal forces from these two members. These two, they are opposite, they will resolve. These two put together will be equal to W. So, this member will become a null member again, is it not? I draw one more trace. With the same conditions, I apply a unit force. So, I can just divide all of them with W, I will get the same value here, which will be half, which will be half. I quickly make a summary table. I will remove this figure, I will make a table here. A member force, I call this as P diagram. I call this as small p diagram. This is unit load. So, force due to the p diagram and force due to the small p diagram. So, let us enter the members A, B, B, C, C, F, F, E, ED AD BD BF and BE, there are one more, write it here. B. It's a null member anyway, so no problem. It's W by 2 and W. I have the length of the member here. I take tensine as positive. Now, which are tension members, which are compression members? I already told you, if I have a member, these are my joints or support condition. If the member is pushing the joint, this is compression. If the member is pulling the joint, it is tension. Look at the force application at the joint, is it pushing or pulling? So put positive for tension, fill up this table quickly. So AB is 0, 0, length of the member is L, BC is also null member, FC is compression minus W by 2 minus 1 by 2 L. This is E. EF is this member, so again minus W by 2 minus 1 by 2 L. ED minus W by 2 minus 1 by 2 L. AD minus W by 2 minus 1 by 2 L. BD are diagonal members, so root 2 L. And they are tensile, so plus W by root 2 plus 1 by root 2. BF is also a diagonal member, so plus W by root 2 plus 1 by root 2 and root 2 L. And of course, BF is a vertical member, BE is a vertical member, is a null member. So 0, 0, yeah. So I have summarized the forces from the P diagram and from the small P diagram, unit load diagram, in a table of form like this. So I will remove this. Let me try to find out P, P, L by AE. P is from here, P is here, L you know, AE is the constant. Why it is constant? The problem says all cross section here the members are constant, L is also equal. Even L is not equal, I am having L value here, I can use it appropriately. And I want you to give me the sum of this with plus minus appropriate. Sorry, last column, yeah, you have to fill up this value, multiply these two with L by AE and put it here, PPL by AE, you are not able to see this, is it? So I will write it bigger, this is P, P, L by AE. The sum will be equal to 2.414 WL by A. Is that okay? So what is this value now? This value now is nothing but the vertical displacement of the truss at the point we are suspending the mass, which is 2.414 WL by A. What is stiffness? Stiffness is force per unit displacement, is it not? Set it to 1 and find out the force. Set it to 1, find out the force. How much it will be? Which will be 0.414 AE by L. Is that okay? Newton per meter. Okay. Mass in kg, but I am holding the problem in W. It is in Newton because it is mg. Okay. Now I have k. The problem says ignore the self weight of the members. If you know m, I can find omega. Okay. I know k. If you know m in the problem, whatever may be the value, I can find omega of the stress. Right. Now what is the interesting part in this problem is that if you have got only a single member subjected to axial pull or axial push, your stiffness would have been only AE by L. If you got parallel members or in series members, you would have got equivalent stiffness. But in this problem, there are members parallel, there are members in series, there are members diagonal also. So what is the net effect of stiffness in the whole truss? That is what I have got. So this stiffness of the whole truss system, which is having parallel members with axial tension or compression, series members with axial tension or compression, in this case there are no series members, and diagonal members. So this is a very easy mechanism which we already studied in our undergraduate level. Same principle I am applying to solve the dynamics problem. So I am getting now k. If I know m given in the problem, I think I can easily find out omega n. So omega n is root of k by m, and m is given, is it not? It is given in the problem. So if you have m, you can easily compute this. Any doubt here? Similar problems of this type. I have one more problem, I do not want to rush through. That is a beam problem. This will take about 15 minutes time. I think we will do it in the next class. This requires more discussion slightly. We will do it in the next class. I do not want to rush up. There are only 3 minutes left over. We will do it next class. So similar problems of this type is expected in your quiz, as well as theoretical derivations, as well as inferences from the figures and response behavior of single degree freedom systems and dynamic response behavior in physical understanding of different offshore structural systems and coastal protection systems, which will be covered in the quiz 1. In addition, I will also talk about 2 degree and multi degree in the coming lectures.